around the world with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor here at the heart of ECTRIMS 2017. We're in these sessions where what we hear is multiple speakers come throughout about an hour and a half, and we have two co-chairs that make sure that we stay on time, make sure that there's great questions that are asked, make sure that the scientific rigor stays very high. And that's why I'm so happy to be joined by Dr. Patrizia Casaccia, who is actually got a very interesting job. She works both with CUNY, so the City University of New York, as well as Mount Sinai, and they have collaborations. And with CUNY, she is the director of neuroscience at the Advanced Science Center. I want to thank you so much for joining us. And the session we listened to was about remyelination. The first question people have at home is, we've heard of demyelination. What is remyelination?
I think remyelination is this wonderful mechanism that we all have in our brain to repair our lesions. And so we can think that 8%, just imagine, 8% of the total cells are oligodendrocyte progenitors. So are basically almost like a little bit more advanced stem cells that we all have in our brain and that we can try to involve in the mechanism of regenerating myelin. We know demyelination is myelin damage and myelin loss. Remyelination is formation of new myelin that will lead to recovery of function. So it's very critical for us to try to understand how can we involve those progenitor cells in generating new myelin.
What have we learned now in 2017 that we didn't know even in 2016 or 2015? It seems like there's been a lot more talk about remyelination. There's a lot more people looking for common generic medicines. People are looking at novel models to create remyelination. Yes. What is new in 2017?
I would say that if we look 1 second at what have been the obstacles in the field, is the fact that we have generated many of the drugs that we're currently using mouse models. And right now in 2017, there is a big and strong emphasis on induced pluripotent stem cells generating from the skin of patients. Those cells can be used to form oligodendrocytes and oligodendrocyte progenitors. And so they're allowing in synthesis in a dish to recapitulate what would happen in a human brain. So we are now discovering drugs that are much more powerful and perhaps we hope will have less of a lag to enter into clinical trials, either because they are already being tested in humans or because we are using drugs that are already FDA approved for other scopes. And so today's session has a lot of interest, showed a lot of interesting data regarding the possibility of using new drugs and presenting new screenings to develop new drugs for regenerating myelin.
Some people have said that it's not so much that the cell, that the body doesn't want to form new myelin. It actually wants to, and then there's inhibitory factors that stop it. Is it more that there's inhibitory factors, or is it more that there's not processes in place to make you form new myelin? And when we're talking about myelin, you mentioned oligodendrocytes. So oligodendrocytes are the cells in the central nervous system that make the myelin sheath. They're different than Schwann cells in the peripheral nervous system. But is it more that something's blocking and we have to get rid of that blocker, or is it more that there isn't that something to make it remyelinate?
I think that we all would want for life to be simple, wouldn't we? And it's not like that. So everybody would want something linear. It's only one component. And what we are learning is that things are not as simple as we thought. Initially, we thought that just by removing the immune cells, or at least trying to control the immune cells, would be sufficient to just generate endogenous repair. We're seeing that's not the case. So I would say it's a combination. We need to wake up the progenitors that are in the brain, and at the same time, we want to make sure that the ones that are already there and they are stalled because of the presence of inhibitors, they can manage to overcome these inhibitory components.
Are you concerned at all if we make the body remyelinate? For some reason, when we're about 4 years old, our body stops making a lot of new myelin. But too much myelin can lead to something called an oligodendroglioma, a cancer of the oligodendrocytes. Are you concerned that in MS, with all of this new research, we may see oligodendrogliomas?
This is an interesting question, because this question has really actually been very present in my own work. And I would say, not really. And the answer is very simple. Oligodendrogliomas as any tumor implies that these progenitor cells proliferate. And proliferation and myelin formation cannot coexist. A cell to form myelin needs to exit from the cell cycle and then, and therefore stop proliferating and then can form myelin. So all these new therapies that we are looking at are geared towards that, towards allowing the progenitors to come out of the cell cycle and myelinate.
Thank you so much, Dr. Patrizia Casaccia, and I want to thank you at home so much for watching. We're really getting to that next level where it feels like we're already in 2020, that we're really gone beyond where we were just 5 years ago. I want to thank you so much, and I want to thank you for watching at home.
Thank you so much.